Denial of service attacks have been in the news recently, and the recent ones have been something called amplified distributed denial of service attacks. This is a fairly straightforward thing, but how we got here is quite interesting. Denial of service attacks have gone on for a long, 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 long time. I can remember being 14, 15 and going on IRC, which is like internet relay chat, like an old school chat service, and irritating people. And IRC to this day remains a haven for the kind of script kiddie type, the cracker type, the type that has downloaded a few slightly dodgy scripts off the internet and thinks they are now an extremely good hacker because of it. And I may have irritated, like 14-year-old me may have irritated a couple of these types. And my home internet connection got denial of service. At that point, my home internet connection was a 56K modem. It is incredibly easy to denial of service attack those, particularly if you happen to irritate someone who is on an enormous university connection at, say, 1 meg, which isn't that much bigger by today's standards, but in those days, all it meant is they set up a little thing on their system, which sends as much traffic as possible to your system. And if their system is bigger than yours, well, your internet connection gets saturated, you can't send anything in and out, at which point I have to literally hang up the phone, dial in again, and get a new IP address so they can't find me. And that was how it worked for a while. And then you start to get the criminals involved who were writing botnets, who were writing viruses that instead of destroying data would go in and take over other people's internet connections. They would find broadband users, generally in the United States or around there, who would be running unsecured versions of Windows XP or 98 or something like that. They would quietly install their software in the background and then would use those unsuspecting users' internet connections to launch a big denial of service attack. This was distributed denial of service. So instead of having one big computer, you had lots of little computers, hundreds, maybe even thousands, maybe tens of thousands, all sending as much traffic as they could against one company. And it didn't matter how big that company's internet connection was, ultimately, 10,000 people all reloading their website or sending as much traffic as possible, as fast as possible, yeah, it's going to take down their net connection. And what was this used for? Well, ransom. What you found in sort of the 2000s was that gambling companies, finance companies, anyone whose job, whose livelihood depended on being up and online all the time was being held for ransom. They would get a call or an email or a message that said, if you don't pay us an amount, your website's going to go down for quite a while. There are defense strategies, sort of. You can generally hire a very expensive company to try and mitigate this, at which point it does become a bit of a protection racket. But ultimately, Microsoft got their act together, the number of zombie computers, as they were called, started falling down, and the internet started getting more and more and more and more bandwidth. And you could hire a net connection that could stand up to reasonable denial of service attacks for not too much. Now the new threat is something called amplified denial of service. And it's not a new threat as such, it's just a new common threat. It's been theorized about for a while. And what it is a combination of a couple of vulnerabilities in how some very old parts of the internet work. Hold that thought, because I need to explain something else first. I need to explain the difference between TCP and UDP. TCP is how most of the web works. It's how the web page that you're viewing, the YouTube page you're viewing this in, gets sent back and forth. And it is a two-way protocol. There's a handshake involved. You request something, and then that request is acknowledged, and you get something back. And as all the packets go back and forth, there is two-way conversation going on, making sure that everything has arrived in the right order, intact. Which means you can use it for web pages, you can use it for financial transactions on your online bank, you can use it for anything where getting everything through bit perfect is required. And then on the other hand, you have UDP. UDP is very much opposite of that. UDP is, here is a stream of data, just deal with it, as much as you can, as fast as you can. Just deal with it. This is what you use for voice over IP. This is what you use for streaming video, live video. Anything where it doesn't matter if a bit of it gets lost, or a bit of it arrives in the wrong order. A part of it. Obviously, a bit is a thing. It doesn't matter if some of it arrives a little bit malformed, as long as most of it gets through. Now, the difference between those is that UDP doesn't really have a handshake. You just kind of point a fire hose of data at something and blast them with it. And because of that, well, it means you don't really have to acknowledge it. You don't have to say, yes, I approve this stream being sent to me. It just kind of arrives and there's not much you can do about it. There is a flaw in the UDP protocol, or at least in some implementations of it and a few other subtle things around the internet, that means I can essentially spoof the return address. My computer here can claim that I'm someone else entirely. And that wouldn't normally be a problem, because most well-designed protocols, and pretty much everything in the internet, will only let you send on a small amount of data. I send a small request to them, they send a small request onwards. And it's not really a problem. Except, there is something called NTP, the Network Time Protocol. And this is the thing that keeps all the clocks in your phone and your laptop in sync to almost to the millisecond. Wonderful thing, great boon to society, unfortunately has a couple of really badly designed things in it. And one of them is this command, monlist. This is the most useless, frustrating, and abused command ever added to anything. It's horrible. What it does is it sends the details of the last 600 people who requested the time from that computer back. I have no idea why you'd add that. I have absolutely no idea why that exists. Why you would need the last 600 people. Why 600? Anyway, what it means is that I can send a tiny request, just this little monlist command here, to the time server, and the time servers are all on enormous connections, spoof where it came from, and they will send an enormous amount of data, 206 times the amount of data to that poor computer there. And more than that, you can work out where this is going. You know, there are many time servers, and let's say I have one of those botnets that I mentioned earlier with zombie computers. Those compromised computers can all send small amounts of data to lots of time servers, and they will all send 206 times the amount of data to this poor sod. This is NTP amplification, but it's not the only amplification attack. There's been DNS for a while. There are a couple of others that security researchers are hinting at, but don't want to release the details of. Not because that'll stop the bad guys. It won't. You can't do security through obscurity. That's the term. But you might at least slow them down a bit. If you're watching this a few months after it's been uploaded, I wouldn't be surprised if we've seen one, maybe two terabit per second attacks. That is 100,000 times more than your broadband connection. It's something that is on the scale of disrupting the entire internet rather than just disrupting one computer. How can you defend against it? Well, you can't. I mean, you can hire a company that claims to be able to block a lot of attacks, and they can, and they can do interesting things at the network level to try and filter it all out. But ultimately, against an attack of that size, which could actually disrupt the infrastructure of the internet itself, there's not much a victim can do. But what you can do is campaign to get the relays, the amplification vectors, shut down. And we've seen this done before. We saw it with open mail relays years ago. There used to be things called open mail relays, which would be just simple sites that would take an email and forward it on. And those were incredible vectors for spam. And they were blocked, and they were filtered, and they were shut down, campaigned against for a long, long time. There's now a generally agreed upon list of these still open, which just won't be able to send anywhere because everyone simply ignores their traffic. This is going to happen sooner or later with relays that still allow spoofing and relays that still allow amplification attacks. Sooner or later, they will get shut down, but until then, well, you just kind of have to hope that no one targets you.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for sponsoring this Computerphile video. And if you'd like to check out one of their huge range of books, get over to audible.com/computerphile and there's a chance to download one for free. I'd like to recommend a book today called Makers by Chris Anderson, which is all about the idea of democratizing the world of making things and manufacturing. So the idea is that the internet has democratized publishing and broadcasting with things like YouTube. And then the same thing is happening to the world of bits and stuff, and it kind of covers the hacker movement. So get over there, check that out. Remember, audible.com, Computerphile, for your chance to download a free book. And thanks once again to them for sponsoring this Computerphile video.